Paul got to his feet and moved around the table. "You're going today?"
"Today it is. And you'll be following tomorrow. Next time we meet, it'll be on the soil of your new world."
He gripped Paul's right arm at the bicep. "Keep your knife arm free, eh? And your shield at full charge." He released the arm and patted Paul's shoulder, whirled and strode out of the door.
"Twofer!" Paul called. Huat turned, standing in the open doorway.
"Don't sit with your back to any doors."
A grin spread across the seamed old face. "I won't, lad. Depend on it." And he was gone, shutting the door softly behind him.
Paul sat down where Huat had been, straightening the papers. One more day here, he thought. He looked around the room. We're leaving. The idea of departure was suddenly more real in him than it had ever been before. He recalled another thing the old woman had said about a world being the sum of many things. The people, the dirt, the growing things, the moon, the tides, the suns. The unknown sum called nature. A vague summation without any sense of the new, of the now. And he wondered, what is the now? The door across from Paul banged open, and an ugly lump of a man lurched through it. It lurched through it, preceded with a handful of weapons.
"Well, Gurney Halleck," Paul called. "Are you the new weapons master?"
Halleck kicked the door shut with one heel.
"You'd rather I come to play games, I know," he said.
He glanced around the room, noting the way Hawat's men had already been over it, checking, making it safe for the ducal heir. The subtle code signs were all around. Paul watched the rolling, ugly man set himself back in motion, veer towards the training table with the load of weapons, saw the 9-string balisette slung over Gurney's shoulder, with the multi-pick woven through the strange strings near the head of the fingerboard. Halleck dropped the weapons on the exercise table and lined them up. The rapiers, the bodkins, the kinjals, the slow pellet stunners, and the shield belts. The ink vine scar along his jawline writhed as he turned, casting a smile across the room.
"So! You don't even have a good morning for me, you young pup," Halleck said. "And that what barb did you sink into old Huat? He passed me in the hall like a man running to his enemy's funeral."
Paul grinned. Of all of his father's men, he liked Gurney Halleck the best, knew the man's moods and devilry, his humors. He thought of him more as a friend than a hired sword. Halleck swung the balisette off his shoulder and began tuning it.
"Well, if you won't talk, then you won't," he said.
Paul stood, advanced across the room, calling out, "Well, Gurney, do we come prepared for music when it's fighting time?"
"So it's sass your elders today,"
Halleck said, and he drew a chord on the instrument and nodded. "Where is Duncan Idaho?" Paul asked. "Isn't he supposed to be teaching me weaponry?"
"Duncan's gone on to lead the second wave onto Arrakis," Halleck said. "All you have left is poor Gurney, who's fresh out of a fight and spoiling for music."
He struck another chord and listened to it, and smiled.
"It was decided in council that you, being such a poor fighter, we'd best teach you the music trade, so you don't waste your life entirely."
"Maybe you'd better sing me a lay, then," Paul said. "I want to make sure how to know not to do it."
"Ha!"
Gurney laughed, and he swung into Galatian Girls, his multi-pick a blur over the strings as he sang.
"Oh, the Galatian girls will do it for pearls and Arrakeen for water. But if you desire dames like consuming flames, try a Caledonian daughter."
"Not bad for such a poor hand with a pick," Paul said. "But if my mother heard you singing such body songs like that in the castle, she'd have your ears on the outer wall for decoration." Gurney pulled at his left ear.
"Poor decoration, too. They've been bruised too much listening at keyholes while a young lad I know practiced some strange ditties on his balisette."
"So you've forgotten what it's like to find sand in your bed," Paul said, and he pulled a shield belt from the table, buckled it fast around his wraith.
"Then, let's fight!"
Halleck's eyes went wide in mock surprise.
"So it was your wicked hand that did the deed! Guard yourself today, young master! Guard yourself!"
He grabbed up a rapier and laced the air with it.
"I'm a hell fiend out for revenge!"
Paul lifted the companion rapier, bent it in his hands, stood at the aguile, one foot forward, and let his manner go solemn in a comic imitation of Dr. Yui.
"What a dolt my father sends me for weaponry," Paul intoned.
"This doltish Gurney Halleck has forgotten the first lesson for a fighting man armed and shielded." Paul snapped the force button at his waist and felt the crinkled skin tingling of the defensive shield at his forehead and down his back. He heard the external sounds take on a characteristic shield-muted flatness.
In shield fighting, one moves fast on defense, slow on attack, Paul said. Attack has the sole purpose of tricking the opponent into a misstep, setting him up for the attack sinister. The shield turns the fast blow and admits the slow kinjal. Paul snapped up the rapier, feigned fast and whipping it back for a slow thrust aimed to enter Hall and into the shield's mindless defenses. Halleck watched the action, turned at the last minute to let the blunted blade past his chest.
"Speed! Excellent!" he said. "But you were wide open for an underhanded counter with a slip tip."
Paul stepped back, chagrined.
"I should whap your backside for such carelessness,"
Halleck said. He lifted a naked kinjal from the table and held it up.
"This is the hand of an enemy that can let your let out your life's blood. You're an apt pupil, none better. But I've warned you that not even in play do you let a man inside your guard with death at his hand."
"I guess I'm not in the mood for it today," Paul said.
"Mood?"
Halleck's voice betrayed his outrage, even through his shield filtering.
"What has mood got to do with it? You fight when the necessity arises. No matter the mood. Mood's a thing for cattle and lovemaking, or playing the balisette. It's not for fighting."
"I'm sorry, Gurney."
"You're not sorry enough."
Halleck activated his own shield, crouched with the kinjal outthrust in his left hand, the rapier poised high in his right.
"Now, I say guard yourself for true!"
He leapt high to one side and then forward, pressing a furious attack. Paul fell back, parrying. He felt the field crackling as shield edges touched and repelled each other, sensed the electric tingling of the contact along his skin. "What's gotten into Gurney?" he asked himself. "He's not faking this." Paul moved his left hand, dropped his bodkin into his palm from his wrist sheath.
"You see the need for an extra blade, eh?"
Halleck grunted. "Is this betrayal?" Paul wondered. "Surely not Gurney." Around the room they fought, thrust and parry, feint and counterfeint. The air within the shield bubbles grew stale from the demands that the slow interchange among barrier edges could not replenish. With each new shield contact, the smell of ozone grew stronger. Paul continued to back, but now he directed his retreat towards the exercise table. "If he can turn him beside the table, I'll show him a trick," Polly thought. "One more step, Gurney." Halleck took the step. Paul directed a parry downwards, turned and saw Halleck's rapier catch against the table's edge. Paul flung himself aside, thrusting high with the rapier and came in across Halleck's neckline with a bodkin. He stopped the blade just an inch from his jugular.
"Is this what you seek?" Paul whispered. "Look down, lad,"
Gurney panted. Paul obeyed and saw Halleck's kinjal thrust under the table's edge, the tip almost touching Paul's groin.
"We'd have joined each other in death," Halleck said. "But I'll admit, you fought some better when pressed to it. You seemed to get the mood,"
and he grinned wolfishly, the ink-fine scar rippling along his jaw.
"The way you came at me," Paul said. "Would you really have drawn my blood?"
Halleck withdrew the kinjal and straightened.
"If you'd fought one whit below your abilities, I'd have scratched you a good one. A scar you'd remember. I'll not have my favorite pupil fall to the first Harkonnen tramp who happens along."
Paul deactivated his shield, leaned on the table to catch his breath.
"I deserve that, Gurney. But it would have angered my father if you'd been hurt me. I'd not have you punished for my failing."
"As to that," Halleck said, "it's my failing too. And you needn't worry about a training scar or two. You're lucky you have so few. As to your father, the Duke'd punish me only if I failed to make a first-class fighting man out of you. Now, I'd have been failing here if I hadn't explained the fallacy in this mood thing that you've suddenly developed."
Paul straightened and slipped his bodkin back into his wrist sheath.
"It's not exactly play we do here," Halleck said.
Paul nodded. He felt a sense of wonder at the uncharacteristic seriousness in Halleck's manner. The sobering intensity. He looked at the beet-colored ink-vine scar on the man's jaw, remembering the story of how it had been put there by the beast Raban in a Harkonnen slave pit on Gedi Prime. And Paul felt a sudden shame, as if he had doubted Halleck even for an instant. It occurred to Paul then that this making of Halleck's scar had been accompanied by pain, a pain as intense, perhaps, as inflicted by a reverend mother. He thrust the thought aside. It chilled him. It chilled them to the world.
"I guess I really did hope for some play today," Paul said. "Things are too serious around here lately."
Halleck turned away to hide his emotions. Something burned in his eyes. There was pain in him, like a blister. All that was left of some lost yesterday that time had pruned off him. How soon must this child assume his manhood, Halleck thought. How soon must he read the form with his mind, that contract of brutal caution, to enter the necessary fact on the necessary line, please list your next of kin. Halleck spoke without turning. I sense the play in you, lad, and I'd like nothing better than to join in. But this no longer can be play. Tomorrow we go to Arrakis. Arrakis is real. The Harkonnens are real. Paul touched his forehead with his rapier blade, held vertical. Halleck turned, saw the salute, and acknowledged it with a nod. He gestured to the practice dummy. Now, we'll work on your timing. Let me see you catch that thing, Sinister. I'll control it over here, so I can have full view of the action. And I warn you, I'll be trying new counters today. It's not a warning you'll be getting from a real enemy. Paul stretched up and on his toes to relieve his muscles. He felt solemn with the sudden realization that his life had become filled with swift changes. He crossed the dummy, slapped the switch on its chest with his rapier tip, and felt the defensive field forcing his blade away. On guard! Halleck called, and the dummy pressed the attack. Paul activated his shield, parried and countered. Halleck watched as he manipulated the controls. His mind seemed to be in two parts, one alert to the needs of the training fight, and the other wandering in a fly buzz. I am the well-maintained fruit tree, he thought, full of well-trained feelings and abilities, and all of them grafted onto me, all bearing for someone else to pick. For some reason, he recalled his younger sister, her elfin face so clear in his mind. But she was dead now, in a pleasure house for Harkonnen troops. She had loved pansies. Or was it daisies? He couldn't remember. It bothered him that he couldn't remember. Paul countered a slow swing at the dummy and brought up his left hand in entrecote. A clever little devil, Halleck thought, intent now on Paul's interweaving hand motions. He's been practicing and studying on his own. That's not Duncan's style, and it's certainly nothing I've ever taught him. This thought only added to Halleck's sadness. I'm infected with mood, he thought. He began to wonder about Paul, if the boy ever listened fearfully to his pillow throbbing in the night. If wishes were fishes, we'd all cast nets, he murmured. It was his mother's expression, and he'd always used it when he felt the blackness of tomorrow on him, when he thought he was used to odd expressions to be taking on a planet. He thought it was odd that he was taking this expression to a planet that had never known sea or fish. That's the end of the chapter. Halleck's voice is really hard to do because it uses a lot of throat and not so much chest. So it's hard to do for long periods of time. Hang on 1 second. Let's see here. Alright, so we got about an hour. Let's start on the next chapter. And then afterwards I can actually get food. Food would be nice. Interesting little tidbit of information. They have made two movies about Dune. The first one was David Lynch and was made in 1984, I believe. It had a theatrical release, and it's a piece of shit, for the record. It's horrible. It's cut all to pieces, and they basically turned an epic book into about a two-hour slog that makes very little to no sense. But it has some great actors in it. Specifically, I bring up the fact that Gurney Halleck in that movie is played by Patrick Stewart. And Kyle MacLachlan of Twin Peaks, who plays the main character in Twin Peaks, he actually plays Paul. Jürgen Prochnow, who is the who was the sub commander in Das Boot, he is Duke Leto, Paul's father. But one of my favorites is the fact that Duncan Idaho is played by, it was a character we haven't met yet. Duncan Idaho is played by Richard Jordan, who unfortunately passed away not too many years ago. but it's kind of, it's got a whole bunch of really great actors in it, and they do